Thank you, Christy, for y'all's singing. Beautiful. We'll be praying for your brother. And thank you for blessing us with those beautiful songs today. I think it may surprise some of you to hear me say this, but I'm going to say it. I don't know how to preach. Some of you figured that out already, but I realize I don't really know how to preach. I mean, I've only been practicing this thing for almost 40 years now. Hard to believe. But what I think part of the problem is people don't know how to listen. People don't listen. More accurately, people don't hear. They just don't hear. And it's not that I haven't tried to get you to hear, but I can see it. I've been doing this a while, and I look back sometimes, and I see the blank stares, and there's so many distractions in church. The people's attention span's about like that, and it doesn't take much for someone to lose their focus of what's going on. And, you know, I can understand. I've been where you are. And, you know, you get things, you're thinking about what's going on later, and your mind is somewhere else, or somebody gets up and you lose concentration. People just don't hear. They don't seem to get it. And it's not like I haven't tried. You know, I mean, I do the work. I've studied under some great preachers. One of my, not only in Bible college, but one of my favorite homiletical professors was Dr. James Callis, who's gone on to be with the Lord. And he was such a wonderful preacher, and he tried to teach us knotheads how to preach a little bit, even to preach without notes. And I could sit in a room and listen to him speak about the groceries or the weather. And he did it in such an eloquent way, it just was captivating. And so I do my homework, and I study, and I try to get ready, and I spend time, you know, looking at the text all week. And then I get up here and I pour it out, and I realize they're not getting it. They're just not getting it. And I see it sometimes, and I think, what is the problem with they're just not seeming to get it? What's going on that they're not getting? I mean, after all, you know, you do this, and I try to come up with a really good sermon, and you know, sometimes, you know what really gets me? Is that sometimes I put a lot into it, and then I realize it flopped anyway. And then I get to thinking, it's a miracle that anybody gets it. Because there are so many distractions between what's going on in the world and what's going on in our personal lives, what's going on in the church, our ADD, sin, all kinds of things, our own hormones, our lives changes and all this. No wonder it's a miracle anybody ever gets it. That you ever get it at all is really, really is. And so we go on and we preach and we do this and we wonder. And I look out sometimes in the congregation, and not just in this church and others, and I'm like, wait, they're not getting it. What am I doing wrong? What am I doing that what do I need to do different so they can get it? And it's kind of like, you know, trying to get people who are of the world to understand heavenly things. You know, Jesus tried that with Nicodemus, didn't he? And Nicodemus didn't get it. And so sometimes it just feels like that, and I think, you know, what is the problem? What is it that's going on? A lot of times people just don't get it, but I want to tell you something. Sometimes they do. Sometimes they do. You know what really gets me sometimes is on those Sundays when I have a sermon that I know it's not a particularly good sermon, and it's one of those that I have I failed miserably at getting my point across, and my illustrations were poor, and I just didn't feel like I had anything to offer. Like some, I wake up and I say, God, I have nothing to give these people. And I do my best, and I stutter, and I stammer, and I walk out back to the back, and somebody walks up to me, reaches out their hand with a tear in their eye and a smile on their face and say, thank you, Pastor. That was meant for me. I got it. And I'm like, you got it? You got what? I know a bad sermon when I hear it, you know, and I didn't do a very good job. I don't know what you got. How did you get anything out of that? It would take a miracle. You see, maybe, just maybe, there's something supernatural that's going on here. One day, John was down at the river, just an ordinary day, baptizing people and preaching the word, just like he did many times. Preaching that the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and basically saying Jesus is coming soon. And people were coming, and some of them would interrupt his sermon with questions like, are you the Messiah? And he would say, no, I'm not the Messiah, but the one coming after me, I'm not even worthy to unloose his sandals. And then people come to be baptized. It was a Jewish form, a ritual at that time, and a baptism of repentance. But then Jesus comes to be baptized, not because he needed to repent of anything, but he wanted to identify with sinners like you and me. And Jesus comes down to the water, and John at first is reluctant to do it, but finally Jesus says it's to fulfill all righteousness, and John reluctantly baptizes Jesus into the water of the Jordan River. And then it happened. Then it happened. All of a sudden, there was a voice. And there was a dove. And the fire fell. Heaven opened up. And God came down. It's kind of like that Forrest Gump show, you know, where Lieutenant Dan shows up at the shrimp boat, and they've been fishing and trying to get any. They couldn't find anything. They were coming up empty, and Lieutenant Dan looks at Forrest Gump and says, where is this God of yours? The storm begins to roll in, and all of a sudden, Forrest Gump says, it's funny that he said that, because right about then, God showed up. Well, I want to tell you, God showed up at the baptism of Jesus. And it's not the only time he showed up. You think about the Mount of Transfiguration, and the face of Jesus was illuminated, and Moses and Elijah comes, and Peter says, it's good that we be here. This is a good place to be. The day of Pentecost, when the fire fell, people got saved and began to speak, and they understood the language of one person speaking. Everybody understood. God showed up. And I think about that, and I realize today that if anybody gets anything that I say, God's going to have to show up. You see, the problem, you know, is not necessarily the preacher. The problem is that we don't hear sometimes. But if we're going to hear, and if we allow our hearts to hear, God could show up, and God will show up if we want Him to. But He shows up not always like the day of Pentecost, not always like the day of baptism of Jesus. John Wesley referred to these as means of grace. Means of grace is sacred moments where you find yourself in the presence of a holy God, where you are aware that there's something supernatural going on, something that's beyond you, something that's beyond this world, that you're in the middle of something holy, and you almost like Moses say, I'm about to take my shoes off because I'm on holy ground. And it may happen to you at your baptism. It may happen to you at the birth of a child. It may happen to you in a church service like this, or at a hospital bed or whatever, but somewhere, sometime, it will happen to you. If it hasn't, it will if you let it. Another thing that amazes me is that I get up here on Sunday morning and I try to preach a sermon, and I realize I blew it. And I look Sunday morning, I come back the next week, and you come back. I'm like, wow, they came back. And I realize, you're not coming for me. There's something going on here that's bigger than you, and it's bigger than me. You're coming for something that I can't even give myself. Some of you have been there. There's been those times in your life, maybe it's been a while, you felt that little touch. Like Christy was singing, the master was awoken. You felt the presence of God in your life. Maybe it's been a while since you felt the presence of God in your life, but you know what the fire feels like. You know what His presence feels like, and you come again because you want to feel that again. And I'm going to tell you today, that unless God shows up, unless the Holy Spirit is involved in our worship, it's not really worship. Song says, brethren, we have met to worship and adore the God above. Will you pray with all your power as we try to preach the word? All is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One comes down. Brethren, pray, and heavenly manna will be showered all around. I'm talking about something real here. I'm talking about something I hope you can experience at one time in your life, because once you have known it, once you've felt it, once you've experienced it, you will never be the same again. And you'll be like that drug addict that's always trying to get that fix again, because you want to feel that power again. Not every Sunday's going to be like the day of Pentecost. I realize that. But having known the presence of God, having felt the loving hands of God wrapped around you, there was nothing in this world like that. Amen? There's just nothing that can ever be described. I can't even make you understand the love of God. And yet, today, I think what we do in our services, everything we do, we understand that unless God is in it, it doesn't have a lot of value. You know, in our church, we don't turn anyone away for communion. And we don't turn anyone away for baptism. We don't care how old you are. And you may say, well, children don't understand. They can't cite the Apostles' Creed, and they don't know the Ten Commandments. They don't get it. If they get it, it would take a miracle. Yeah. And so what we do is we do it in sort of a promise. As we bring our children, we say we're going to raise them up in the Lord, and with the hope and a promise that someday they will get it. Someday they'll be sitting in the church like you and are right now, and the word will be preached. And maybe they've heard that same word 1,000 times, but all of a sudden it'll be different that time. And they'll hear the voice of heaven. Not long ago, I was asked to go visit a patient, and this particular patient I'd seen many times before, and he had been at death's door before, but this time was different. He said, I want to get right with God. He said, I've had too many chances, and I know there's going to come a time I'm going to come in here and I won't get to go out of the hospital. Now, what did I do? Nothing. I just showed up, but more importantly, God showed up. The Bible says that no man cometh to the Father unless my Spirit draws him to Him. And so today, it's all about the presence of Christ.